us, so this is the fourth time that we run this event. And every year we have it around the International Rare Disease Day. And we would like, with this event and also with the Rare Disease Day in general, we would like to raise awareness of rare diseases, of the patient organizations, and the theme for this year is research. So we are doing research on rare diseases, so we fit right in. And what are rare diseases, and are they really so rare? So a rare disease is affecting one in 2,000 or less people. And it sounds rare first, but there are over 6,000 rare diseases, and taken together, they are actually not that rare, because just in the UK alone, they affect 3 million people. So actually, it's 1 in 17 of us that can be affected by a rare disease. So they are not that rare. In fact, and many of them share mechanisms and share it with more common diseases, so it makes sense to research them. And for many of these rare diseases, there are no cures and only few treatments available, so there is a lot of research still left to do. So we are, so today we are going to show you a bit of the research we do here at the Institute of Genetic Medicine and at the Center for Life.
I'm a stand-in for the young, good-looking guy who now runs a place called Joris Velfen, who's had to go to Holland, so he called me up and said, could I step in? And by chance, I just had to go and give a talk very like this one for 20 minutes in London at the Royal Institution. And I was asked to explain how to cure cancer in 20 minutes, so I thought I might as well just share that with you, and I hope you enjoy it. So before I actually go on to that slide, I should just say the one before, where have I gone backwards here? No, I can't go backwards. Anyway, you saw the ancient names of the North. I was actually telling all the people in London that the ancient North was 20 years old last week. And I actually had the great honour to present Anthony Gormley for his honorary degree up at the university with all the water boards and the big gear on. And I was standing in front of the Chancellor in this big crowded room, and I said, Anthony Gormley, what can I say? I was planning to say that for about an hour before. I thought, what if they don't laugh? You know, how embarrassing. Yeah, well, they did laugh pretty good. So, I mean, obviously, as you probably know, Anthony Gormley used his own body as the model for the Edge of the North. And so it's basically his body made of iron. But your bodies are made of cells. And I looked up on Google, because I suddenly thought, I can't remember exactly how many cells we've got. Turns out, look, 37.2 trillion cells in your body, which is a lot. And every one of those cells contains, or not everyone, but almost everyone, contains its own set of chromosomes, which are in each one of those is a tightly bound molecule of DNA. And your genome is contained in that little set of chromosomes. So you've got 37.2 trillion copies of your whole genome. And every time your cells start feeling a bit unwell, they divide to replace and repair themselves. So there's a constant repair and replacement process going on all the time, even as we're sitting here. And as this picture, actually it's nice a bit bright, that's from Dunkirk, I'm sweat CEO, great film. Basically it reminded me of what's happening to your bodies. As we speak, every one of your 37 trillion cells are under attack. Now, if you have bad habits and you smoke and you drink too much and you eat the wrong food, like the chicken bake I just had for breakfast on the way here, then those things can actually damage your cells, and so you have to keep fixing them. But even if you are the best behaved person on the planet, you're still sitting on a planet which gets bombarded with cosmic rays and stuff, and there's radiation from the granite under our feet. So there's actually damage to your cells all the time, and your cells have to keep fixing their DNA. And it breaks a stunning amount. So just breathing oxygen brings in oxygen reactive species which cause damage, which also has to be repaired. And it's estimated we do about 100,000 repairs a day just to repair those changes. So your DNA is constantly being broken and needs to be copied and it needs to be repaired. So if you pick up enough mistakes in a cell, it can actually become a cancer cell. And probably the most famous cancer in the world was suffered by Henrietta Lacks. If you want to hear the whole story of Henrietta Lacks, that program and tag there on BBC we did last year, last March. So Henrietta Lacks was a poor African-American who lived in Baltimore, where I did some of my training. And she presented in 1951 with a cervical cancer. Now we actually know the primary cause of that is called human papillomavirus, and it infects the cells in the neck of the womb and kind of persuades them to start behaving badly, mainly so it can make more copies of itself, but in the process it starts to do damage that could lead to cancer. And in fact, Henrietta's cancer was so dramatically malignant that it could divide almost without control. And in fact, it was used to make the first polio vaccine, because it was the first time a human cell line had proven able to just keep on going and keep on repairing and replacing and dividing. In fact, it's not very human. It's got 82 chromosomes, so it's very different from the original cell it came from. But it's picked up lots of changes that made it basically immortal. And so there are said to be about 60 tons of Henrietta's cancer all over the world in research laboratories that are being used to do experiments. And something like 20,000 scientific papers have been written based on that cell line. So actually, in fact, somebody actually wanted to give it its own species name, because it's actually a new form of life. So basically, that's a dramatic example of what happens in cancer. All cancers are essentially a genetic problem in a cell where it's lost control and started to behave badly. But it's even more complicated than that, because the original cell, as with Henrietta, it didn't have 82 chromosomes at the start. It kept on making more mistakes. Some of them killed a cell line, others made it stronger. So we've got this idea called clonality, and we think of it like a tree. So if you imagine the virus that triggered her cancer was the stem or the trunk of this tree. As the cancer grows, each cell picks up more mistakes, and some of them are good, some of them are not so good. So you get a whole range of different spelling mistakes across a cancer. You might have 1,000 different cell lines in any one cancer, all of them with their own particular collection of tricks that allow them to survive. And that makes them very harder to treat. And so one of the things as geneticists we're really interested in is understanding what the sort of stem, what the first mutation or change was, because all of the cells in the cancer will share that same spelling mistake, and that's a target for us to go after. So this is a very complicated slide, I just showed, because this is a very complicated subject. I mean, all of biology is wrapped up into cancer genetics, but I just want to illustrate a general point. So Hanahan Weinberg published this paper in 2011, where they tried to pull together all of the things that a cell might have to do in order to become a cancer cell, able to grow without any attention to its neighbors and just divide and eat anything it wants and steal from its friends, etc. And these are all the things that it would have to do. And around there are the different treatments that we've been developing over the last 20 or 30 years to try and hit those different driver mutations, as they're sometimes called. And I'm going to just talk about three or four of them. First of all, I'm going to talk about kinases. Now, you know the word kinetic and kinase, it means to run. It comes from the word to run. So enzymes that are called kinases make things run. They just drive cells to divide, and they just keep on going as fast as they can. So that's one of the targets. Another target is tumor suppressors. I'm going to talk about tumor suppressors, and I'm going to talk about bouncers. I want to see if you can work out why. So tumor suppressors are very important, because they're the genes that check to make sure that all cells are behaving, and they basically control cells and stop them going out of control and dividing. Immune destruction, we're going to be hearing later from some of our experts in immune treatment, because this is really important. We've got a fantastic immune system, like a huge standing army that defends us against infection, but it also defends us against cells that misbehave. And so a lot of our defense against cancer is built around our immune system spotting cells behaving badly and destroying them. And we've worked out how to enhance that, as we'll tell you about later. And then the last two are particularly interesting, the area where my research is mainly focused. First of all, inflammation. Inflammation, you all recognize inflammation when you've got a swollen ankle or wrist or whatever. So inflammation actually is part of the cancer process in which we don't really fully understand, but inflammation seems to protect cancers, probably from the immune system getting in to attack the cells themselves. Programmed cell death is one of the critical things that our all creatures use this, particularly complex multi-system organs like ours, or multicellular organisms like ourselves, where if a cell behaves badly, you tell it to die. It has a big self-destruct button that kills itself when it's not doing what it should be doing. And that's one of our primary sort of defense systems against cancer. So I'm going to illustrate those few examples of this big, rather complicated field. The first one I want to talk about is kinases. Back in the 1970s, when I was doing my first genetics degree, a lady called Janet Rowley in Philadelphia spotted that people with chronic myeloid leukemia, which as the name suggests, it's a blood cancer and affects all people, you often, in fact, almost always saw a tiny little extra chromosome. Remember, the chromosomes, each one of them is a tightly wound DNA molecule. But that little tiny one in the middle that's got a yellow tag on it is an abnormal chromosome. It doesn't look like it should. And it turned out, as we now know, is that down at the bottom left-hand corner there's a green one, which is chromosome 22. And up in the top, these lights are very bright. You can maybe see a red one, and that's chromosome 9. And what's happened is that two chromosomes broke, because they break all the time, and repairmen come and put them back together again. But imagine two chromosomes break simultaneously, and the man comes from the council with his bag, and he picks up two bits, and he puts them back together, but they were the wrong bits. So he actually took a bit off 22 and stuck it to a bit of 9. That's called a translocation. And that particular translocation, if it happens in your bone marrow, creates a kinase. The two bits of DNA that put together makes an abnormal gene that makes a kinase. And so the minute that starts happening, that cell has now got a little driver motor inside it that says divide, divide, divide. And it just keeps on going. And so you have suddenly millions and millions of copies of that cell, that white blood cell, completely filling your bloodstream. So you've got white blood, leukemia. What was exciting was the discovery that once we understood that mistake, people started playing with different drugs to try and block that abnormal gene. And they came up with a drug called imatinib. Imatinib had actually been developed for another purpose, and in fact, they just tried it and it worked. And they got it onto the market so quickly, they didn't have a name for it. So they had a name on the shelf called Gleevec, which was actually for something else, and they called it Gleevec, and it was a blockbuster drug, because effectively it cured chronic myeloid leukemia. It just basically took out the driver mutation for that type of cancer. So that was the big breakthrough of kinases, and there's huge fascination now in understanding all the different kinases and how we can use that to prevent cancer or treat cancer. Can we take these lights down? It's awfully bright up here, but you can't see the slides very well. We're going to have the same problem the next door. So if you can just about see that picture of a little girl called Emily, who we saw 25 years ago at the hospital, and Michael Clark, our ophthalmologist, saw it. And a mum brought her in because she'd taken a picture, and I think you can probably see she got one white eye. So she thought she had cataracts. She thought she'd developed a cataract, because that's what happens when you take a picture of a cataract. But actually, it wasn't a cataract, that was a cancer in her eye. It's called a retinoblastoma. So the retina, the colour, the light sensitive bit in the back of the eye, develops after you're born. It doesn't finish growing until you're about 5. So it has embryonic cells that are still able to sort of divide naturally to finish making your retina. And if you make a mistake in one of the control genes, those embryonic cells just keep on going and start heaping up, and you end up with a big pile of cells. And in fact, she had to have her eye removed to actually take that cancer out. There was no way to cure it. If you knew it was coming, we now cure those with a laser. So we actually, kids who are at risk of this, we check their eyes every 3 months and blast any bits of retinoblastoma that are going before they get going. And after you're 5, it won't happen. Now, back in 1971, a guy called Al Knudsen, another American, who had the pleasure to have visited here once, had this idea, because he started studying these kids. Now some kids, most kids who get retinoblastoma just get in one eye, but some of them get it in both eyes. And that made us all think that it must be genetic. as a rare disease. And indeed, in those families, you'd see it running in the family, children being born with two retinoblastomas. And so he studied the age of onset of those children with retinoblastomas. And what he found was the kids who had bilaterals, that's a square line there, it was a straight line. So this is what proportion of them haven't yet got the disease. So 100% at birth, but you can see that over the first few months of life, up to five, more and more of them will have developed their retinoblastomas, but it was a straight line. So whereas he looked at the single cases, which were just sporadics, that was a curved line, and he cleverly worked out that that must mean that there were two things had to go wrong to give you retinoblastoma in the usual course of events. So one of our big problems in our diagnostic service is sorting the wheat from the chaff, working out which spelling mistake is a problem and which one isn't. And so one of the things I'm involved with, this is Angelina when she announced her surgery, and she doubled our referrals for breast cancer overnight all across the world. She had the biggest impact that anybody's ever had in terms of teaching genetics, because everybody suddenly realized this was something they wanted to know about. But the problem is, we don't know which spelling mistakes. We haven't sorted out yet, even in BRCA1, the most common of these genes. We haven't worked out which spelling mistakes are definitely causative of cancer. So I'm involved in two projects. Out of Newcastle, the Human Variome Project is an NGO, non-governmental organization of UNESCO, and we run it across the street. And it's basically gathering data on all the spelling mistakes in different genes. And we're now teamed up with a big organization looking at whole genome data called the Global Alliance for Genomics and Health. And I'm co-leading a project called the BRCA Challenge. And what we've done is got all the people in the world to tell us all the spelling mistakes they've ever found in BRCA1 and BRCA2 and put them all in one place. And we've got them on a website called BRCAExchange.org. So far we've got 19,000 of them sent. And about a third of those will be very important. So what we're going to do with our international team is sort this out so that in future, a doctor in the clinic gets told that a patient's got a spelling mistake in BRCA1, they can look at what they're for and say, is that a cause of cancer or not? Should this person be referred to have regular MRIs of the breast or not? And we need to do that for all 20,000 genes. So we've got a lot on. But in terms of cancer, there are about 100 genes like BRCA1 where we particularly need to understand the spelling mistakes because they are so important. And broadly speaking, about 1% of the population has a problem with one of those genes. So, as you heard, although rare diseases are rare, put them all together, they start to become quite common. So, I want to just tell you now, related to BRCA1, a fantastic breakthrough, nothing to do with me, but I'm proud of it because it's joy. And so the Newcastle team, the chemists in Newcastle, working with the Institute of Cancer Research up the hill next to medical school, started a project under Herbie Newell and Hilary Calvin back in the mid-90s to try and find new drugs to treat cancer. So first of all, before I show you this, just ignore that for a moment. Generally speaking, the drugs we use to treat cancers that are established are DNA-damaging drugs, which sounds a bit weird, but basically, cells that are dividing quickly have to copy their DNA. So the more quickly you divide, the more vulnerable you are to mistakes in your DNA. So if you give somebody a nasty drug that damages all their DNA, the rapidly dividing cells are the ones that get hit the hardest. So that's why you feel awful when you get chemotherapy, because your whole body's been hit. But the cancer cells are particularly hit because of their rapid division. So one of the main focuses of attention of cancer researchers was finding out how to mess up DNA repair, because that would be a good way of killing cancers. And so the team up this hill started looking at an enzyme called PARP. Now PARP, you all remember, was what Noddy's car did when he went past Billy. But PARP is poly-ADP ribose polymerase. You have to practice in front of the mirror to get that one right. And PARP, actually, whenever you get a single strand break, then you have to go through a process called base excision repair, and you collect together a whole bunch of your friends to go and repair that break. And PARP is the key enzyme that makes that work. So they said, let's try and work out chemicals that can kill PARP or stop PARP working. And they invented PARP inhibitors. Now, PARP inhibitors on their own don't actually do much at all. They help other drugs, but they don't help much in general because there's a backup plan. If you block the A1 at Chesney Street, it doesn't cause massive tailbacks because everybody just switches on to the old A1 and goes round and comes back on further down. So the body has a backup plan. if you have a block in your single strand breaks, you've got this other wiggly woggly road called homologous recombination, which is much more complicated, but it works. So you basically convert your breaks into a double strand break and you repair it by a different route. However, if you've got a cell in your breast which has got two copies of BRCA1 knocked out, it can't do this because right in the middle is BRCA1 and just a bit further down is BRCA2. So any person who's got a cell which has lost both copies of BRCA1 can't use that bypass system. So a PARP inhibitor will kill that cell, but it doesn't kill the rest of you because the rest of you can still go around the outway. That makes sense? So PARP inhibitors were invented here, and the first one was called, it's called rucaparib. It's now just being licensed, and our university is going to get a shed load of money because of the patents on these new PARP inhibitors. AstraZeneca, the big British pharmaceutical company, developed another one called olaparib, which I've been helping them to develop and promote. And olaparib is already out on the street making a packet of money because it's a very targeted treatment for any BRCA deficient cancers. So that's really exciting because it's a sort of direction of travel towards what we're calling synthetic lethality. So we basically killed those cells by knowing what they are weak in and targeting that with our drugs. So my second story and last story is about another type of genetic cancer called Lynch syndrome, named after an old friend of mine called Henry Lynch in Omaha, Nebraska. And he popularized this in the 1970s, although in fact it was also discovered by a couple of doctors down in Durham at exactly the same time. We have a huge family in Durham with 45 people with bowel cancer, all in the same family. And so this is another big family from Northumberland, and Ted was a shepherd in Berwick. And we were tracking the gene in this family by what's called linkage analysis, and with our colleagues in Leeds, we just worked out that it was on chromosome 2, when it was announced that by a team in Baltimore, these cancers, there was something weird about them, they had lots and lots of spelling mistakes in them, all over the place. And a team in Boston, led by Richard Kolodner, were yeast geneticists. Now yeast are just like our cells, they're very simple, but they basically have the same kind of structure. And if you knock out mismatch repair genes in yeast, they pick up spelling mistakes. So I said, maybe that's the cause. So we sent some of Ted's DNA to Boston, and they used the yeast copy of the gene to pull out the Ted's copy of the gene, and found it had a spelling mistake in it. So that was the beginning of our understanding of a whole new way of repairing DNA in humans called mismatch repair. Now, we reckon that around about 4 people in every 1,000 in this country has an inherited defect in that particular repair system of mismatch repair. So that's a lot of people. We think there's probably about 175,000 people walking around at risk of bowel cancer in particular because of this condition. So the particular thing that goes wrong here is called microsatellite instability. Basically, if you look along your DNA is written in 4 letters, A, C, G, and T, and there are bits where you get the same letter over and over and over again. You make it 25 T's in a row. Now, if I asked you to get a piece of paper right now and copy that down, there's a very strong chance you'd get it wrong, because it's quite hard to count exactly how many T's there are. And our body has the same problem. So if you slip, that's really important, because your DNA is read, each word is 3 letters long. So each 3 letters represents 1 building block. If you stick in 1 extra letter, everything moves down 1, so it's called a frame shift. So you now got a whole set of wrong amino acids, because everything's out of line. Except now, that gets fixed. If it slips, the thing is it slips, the DNA is 2 strands, and if you put an extra T in, the 2 strands have to stick together, but it won't stick together properly because it's not in line anymore. So the body can spot that and sends these proteins which kind of clamp around the mistake and strip that bit off and run it again. And all the time, while we're sitting here, every cell in your body, or many of the cells in your body, are using this system to spell check its DNA to make sure it's copying correctly. Now that has an interesting effect. If you get slippage, so for example, this is very important, this is a friend of mine called Magnus von Knebel Dürkowitz. He has to have an extremely long checkbook to write check. But Magnus is an immunologist in Heidelberg that I've been working with for many years. And he's really interested in these so-called frame shift peptides. So basically this is a gene which helps to control cancer, called TGFB receptor 2. And in the middle of it, there are 10 letter A's in a row. And they worked out that if you actually slip back one letter to 9 letters, you'd get different set of amino acids and the premature stop codon. And if you went back to 8 A's, you get a different set of amino acids and a premature stop codon. And those frame shift peptides are only seen when this happens. Okay, so they're abnormal peptides. And so if you've got, like with the BRCA, if you've got a breakdown of your mismatch repair, you've got a cell in your core that's accumulating these spelling mistakes and producing all these frame shift peptides, which are weird. The body's never seen them before. And your immune system says, I don't know what that is. Send in the police and kill it. Because the police force in our immune system is pretty, they don't take prisoners, they just kill things. So they go after it and actually attack these cells. Now, you're going to hear later about this, but a couple of years ago, a new class of drugs was developed, which is basically like telling everybody in America with an M16 to go out and shoot where they can find, right? Which happens quite a lot in America, as you know. And so basically your white cells are kept under control by a very elaborate system saying, don't kill anybody. But these drugs say, oh, I'll go on, kill anybody. And they just unleash your immune system to kill things. And of course, if you've got cells that are generating all these abnormal proteins, they kind of say, hey, look at me, and they get killed. So this is called a waterfall plot. And this is where you start. Did you get smaller or do you get bigger as a cancer? And what they discovered in 2015 was that cells which were mismatch repair deficient, that's the black and the green ones, either bowel or non-bowel, they just fell apart when you unleash the immune system to attack anything visible.
Looking through the history of this, there's been a few events that have come along to make us change our minds on this. As early as the 1960s, 70s, when the widespread use of immunosuppressant drugs were used in order to allow people to have transplants of solid organs and bone marrow, and so these people were immunosuppressed for many years, it was noticed that these people tended to get more cancers. And the cancers they tended to get were things like lymphoma. And the explanation back then was it wasn't to do with the immune system being protecting us against the lymphoma. It was the fact that because we didn't have an immune system, we were getting more viruses, and then the viruses were causing the lymphoma. 10 years later, drugs that ramp up the immune system started to be used as treatments. So one of the earliest ones was the use of the anti-TB vaccine, BCG, which is injected into people's bladders to cause inflammation. It was noted that the people who had cancer in the bladder, it would often go away just by activating the immune system. And it's a treatment that's still used today. We've heard about chronic myeloid leukemia. This particular leukemia is notable in this story because it's very sensitive to being treated by having a bone marrow transplant. In the few people that have a bone marrow transplant to treat chronic myeloid leukemia, occasionally the leukemia would come back. And it was noticed that if you gave somebody the immune cells, specifically the T cells, which I'm going to talk about, you just inject a few number of T cells, you can often, they would recognize the chronic myeloid leukemia as foreign and destroy it. And it was one of the first ever examples of using immune cells to treat a cancer successfully. That led to changes in the way we do bone marrow transplants. So traditionally, a bone marrow transplant was a procedure done where we would give a massive amount of chemotherapy and then rescue somebody by giving them somebody else's bone marrow transplant. It was thought by using more chemotherapy, that would be the way in which the transplant would work. It was really realized that what the benefit of a transplant was less the amount of chemotherapy being received, but more the fact that you're putting in the immune system of somebody else who would then see both the patient as foreign and their cancer as foreign. And then finally, in the 1990s, we had the introduction of antibodies directed against markers on cancers, and for the first time they actually started successfully killing cancer. So I've mentioned about T cells, I thought I'd explain this. This is a very particular type of cell within the immune system. They're often referred to as the generals of the immune system. They're the ones that tell the difference between our cells and foreign or infected cells. So if we take a case where somebody gets a cold virus, so you can see the virus represented here, and this may be a cell within your nose, and the virus goes inside the cell and then makes copies of itself within the cell, and then those copies are released to infect other cells. But now we can make antibodies against those cells, those viruses, but the virus spends most of its time inside a cell, so an antibody isn't really going to work for most of the time that the virus is hiding inside a cell. So the immune system has a component that handles this problem, and these are T cells. So within all our cells, we have a special little protein that's known as the MHC, and the purpose of that protein is to pick up other proteins from inside the cell and present it on the surface of the cell. So it's a bit like a spy. It's a way of giving information outside of the cell of things inside the cell. And our T cells have another protein known as a T cell receptor, and if that is fits the shape of the virus that's now being expressed on the outside of the infected cell, that T cell will go on and kill the cell. And each T cell has a different T cell receptor, which is a different shape, and you'll have a specific T cell that protects us against chickenpox, or another one against rabies, or whatever. And they will only see cells, so the T cell that has a receptor against the shape of a rabies virus will only infect and kill rabies infected cells. And the purpose of a vaccine essentially is to activate this population of T cells so you have large numbers of them floating around. Now, if you put it in a little bit more detail, this is a kind of more scientific picture of what I've shown. So here we have our little target cell over here, which is infected, and here we have our T cell. And the T cell receptor binds to that MHC, which contains a piece of that virus on it. If it doesn't contain the piece of the virus, then the T cell receptor doesn't bind the MHC. So non-infected cells are unaffected. But in addition to that, we have another set of receptors here that are there to regulate this process. And these are known as co-receptors. So on the surface of the infected cell, you'll have a co-receptor on one side and a T cell on the other. And some of these have a positive role. So these are stimulatory co-receptors. And there's another family that are inhibitory. And one of the most best understood inhibitory ones is known as PD-1. So under here, This would be PD-1, and it would bind to its ligand, which is known as PD-L1. So if a cell expresses PD-L1, it's protected against the immune system. The T cell will come up to it and then get shut down. You may wonder why we have this sort of complex network of regulators, and that's just to protect us against having autoimmune disease. So our own uninfected cells will be expressing things that will shut the T cells down, and infected cells will tend to have things that will enhance the immune system to attack and destroy those cells. And not surprisingly, cancer cells know about this and they've hijacked this system. So a lot of cancer cells express this ligand PD-L1. And you often have many cancers where when you look down the microscope, there's huge numbers of T cells inside the cancer, but they don't seem to be doing anything, sort of frustratingly marching around, unable to do anything. And it's possible now that we've now made antibodies that either block that PD-L1 or block the PD-1. And then suddenly all of these T cells that are marching around inside the cancer are now let free to then attack the cells. And a very good example of this is a type of lymphoma called Hodgkin disease, where you look inside the Hodgkin disease tumor, this big lump, almost 90% of all those cells are just T cells running around. The number of Hodgkin's cells are very, very few inside this huge lump. And not surprisingly, Hodgkin's disease is probably the disease that these antibody, anti-PD-1, has been most successful at. It cures about 90-95% of patients with Hodgkin's disease. There are a few other cancers which are associated with lots of T cells infiltrating them. Melanoma is another one, and it's relatively sensitive to the effect of PD-1. The other thing of note is if you have a patient who's had a bone marrow transplant where the immune system is foreign and sees both the patient's cancer and themselves as foreign and is always trying to attack them, if those patients have their cancer relapses after the transplant and you give them this anti-PD-1 antibody, it's extremely effective. And you can often give microscopic doses of PD-1 and the relapsing cancer gets treated very effectively. But it's at a cost, and that is that not only do the T cells then attack the cancer, but they attack the patient, causing a disease called graft versus host disease. The last thing to say about PD-1 is it seems to be very effective initially, but we've got no idea whether this benefit is long term. And we don't really know whether on its own it's actually going to be curing cancers. But it certainly can put people in remission, and it can be seen as a bridge to another therapy.